Welcome back. Coming up is session 3 from the Provision Entrepreneurs Conference with Simon T. Bailey. Simon T. Bailey believes each of us is born brilliant. Then we spend the rest of our lives having our brilliance buried by people, circumstances, and experiences. Eventually, we forget that we ever had genius and special talents, and our brilliance is locked away in a vault deep within. So we settle for who we are instead of striving for who we were meant to be. In this session, Simon gives you the combination to the vault where your brilliance is kept. Simon's story is inspiring. After struggling for 32 years with disillusion, defeat, and despair, Simon cracked the code to personal transformation, turning his life around and becoming a highly successful entrepreneur, respected family man, and community leader. Simon has a very unique style to help people transform. Using the metaphor that we're all diamonds in the rough, he shares the 4 key steps to cut and polish the gem that is you in order to reawaken your genius, reignite your internal light, and release your potential. He guides your transformation with interactive tools such as personal appraisal exercises, diamond polishing action steps, and true stories of living diamonds. So let's join Simon T. Bailey in session 3 from the Provision Entrepreneurs Conference and learn how to create lasting change and release your brilliance.
Thank you so much. Bless you. You can be seated. Thank you. Within the last decade, I have been on 6 continents, and I can honestly say that this is probably one of the first audiences in a long time where I have felt loved, I have felt your energy, and I just want to say thank you. Thank you. You can tell a lot about people by their leader, and how many of you love your pastors here? Give it up for them, absolutely. Awesome. I called Renee on last night. Renee is my wife, and I called her on last night, and I said, babe, Gary and Drenda, they're different. They're cool. They're not like weird and spooky and religious. You know, I've been in the church all my life, and I've been there, done that, got the t-shirt, and I'm kind of like done, you know? I'm like, I don't need all the drama, all the accoutrements, everybody that thinks they're all that in a bag of chips. Can you just be real, you know? Just be real, you know? Be real. And there is a real authenticity that I sense and I picked up. And thank you. Thank you for just being you. Just thank you for being you. It's awesome. Awesome. A couple of years ago, Renee and I, with the kids, we were at the San Diego Zoo, which is probably one of the top 10 zoos in the country. And Daniel is our oldest, Madison is our youngest, and Madison was observing one of the exhibits there, and we said Madison, or there was another couple, and they said Madison, and we said Madison at the same time, and we noticed that there were 2 Madisons that happened to be standing next to each other, their daughter, our daughter. So we kind of, you know, wandered over to them and just, you know, exchanged hi, how are you? That's it. You know, it's funny that you have a daughter named Madison. We have a daughter named Madison. And for the next couple of hours, Renee, myself, Daniel, and Madison, we spent time with Bonnie and Boomer, their Madison, just walking around the zoo. And didn't know these people from Adams, but just felt a connection with them, and we were talking to them. And Boomer and Bonnie live in Billings, Montana. And Boomer and I, we were talking, and turns out we thought a lot alike, and we saw the world through probably the same lens, that he worked in a coal mine area. I'm a city guy, so he began to tell me about the country, and I told him I've always wanted to go fly fishing, and I wanted to take Daniel fly fishing. And he said to me, he said, if you ever come out to Montana, we want you to stay at our house. Now, mind you, we didn't know these people at all, but they said, we want you to stay at our house, because you just really felt we had a connection with them. And what was so amazing about that, in that moment, I realized that respect has no color. I realized that Boomer and I can carry a conversation. Bonnie and Renee were talking like they had known each other for years. And what I really realized, a lot of times the problem in our country is that we're talking at each other and not to each other. And it doesn't matter your socioeconomic background or your ethnicity or the pigmentation of your skin. When Jesus died on the cross, he died for all of us. So when I understand that, I realize that the love I have, the respect that I have, it comes from the Father, not me, because probably 20 years ago, I would have never engaged a Boomer or a Bonnie in a conversation. But what I really realize is that we're all human beings. And once we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, I love you because he first loves you. So I am deeply honored to be here and to be in a mixed company, because this is what heaven's going to look like. You know, this is what heaven's going to look like. Whatever we come with, our background. I was in Lima, Peru not too long ago, and I stood up and I said, "Hola amigos, mi nombre es Simon T. Bailey, tus eres brillante." That means, hello, my name is Simon T. Bailey, you are brilliant. Because I realized that I needed to create a point of connection. I think God has got a little salsa in him. Ha ha! Ha ha ha! Ha ha ha! So, for the next few moments, I want to pick up on this whole thought of intuition for wealth. And I want us to go to the next slide. I want us to go to the next slide. And as we begin to walk through this, I don't want you to hear what I'm saying. I want you to catch what I mean. And I want you to hear in the deeper place in your heart like you've never heard before. Is that okay? All right. So let me set it up with this story. Recently, in Forbes magazine, they showcase its annual list of billionaires. According to Steve Forbes, editor-in-chief, this year's list includes 200 more billionaires than the previous year. He goes on to say that the overwhelming majority of billionaires have moved ahead through meeting the needs and wants of other people. He also says the entrepreneurial spirit is showing surprising resiliency worldwide. Now, one of the interesting stories in the Forbes magazine billionaire list is the story of a man by the name of Hum Hat Ong. He is 44 years of age, and he is Vietnam's first billionaire. What's interesting about his story is that in the early 1990s, after marrying his college sweetheart, they moved to the Ukraine, a nation that was struggling in its own capitalistic development. He began to scrape together $10,000 from family and friends, and he opened a Vietnamese restaurant in the Ukraine. Everybody got it? Now, catch this, because when we talk about the intuition for wealth, it says that he began to sense a demand, and he began making and drying ramen noodles. Ramen noodles are like Chinese noodles. They're strong, they're the long ones. They're made out of egg and wheat. And he began to use a production line to import these noodles from Vietnam. This concept of instant noodles was completely new to the Ukrainians and became an instant hit. Soon, FOM took a risk. Everybody say, take a risk.
Take a risk.
Rather than run a small noodle shop that he had scraped together $10,000, he bet everything by borrowing money at an interest rate of 8% and expand. Now, 8%, how many know that's high? I mean, that's almost highway robbery. An interest rate of 8%, and he expanded his production line for dehydrated mixes that the Vietnamese chefs traditionally use to season noodle soup. He engaged the market. Now, check this out. When you sense something, you have to pay attention to your intuition, to your gut, and you have to do something that goes against the grain, that everybody is not doing. Because if you just come to market with something, people will TiVo you out of their lives. So he, to seed the market, he engaged the market by producing a 500,000 small packages, and he gave them all away along with a Vietnamese calendar. As he seeded the market, all of a sudden it caught on and he became the Ukraine's processed food king. 17 years later, after that $10,000 investment of scraping his money together, he sold his company to Nestle for $150 million. Now, put it in a context. Vietnamese, all of a sudden I sense, Mary's a sweetheart, I sense that it's time to move to the Ukraine. How many realize the Ukraine is far away from Vietnam? So he moves there, sells his company to Nestle, but during that time, as he was making money, he was sending money back to Vietnam, and he began to buy up real estate in Vietnam. So the bulk of his wealth that allows him to be the first billionaire in Vietnam is in commercial real estate. It is my belief that you will reach a point where you have a sense to create wealth like you have never before in the history of your life. Here in the United States, the census report a few years ago stated that 84% of the business income is controlled by 3% of the business owners. So the question is, that leaves 97% of the business owners to chase after the other 16% of the business income. So the question then becomes, what is it that the 3% know that the 97% don't know? Everybody tracking with me so far? In a recent online article that appeared in the Huffington Post, it was entitled, Klinkle Drives Exodus from Stanford University as students flock to be a part of the next big startup. A dozen students, and this article just appeared about 3 weeks ago, a dozen students at Stanford put their degrees on hold to join a new startup in one of the largest ever departures from the university's computer science program. They left to join a new mobile payment company called Klinkle, which hasn't even launched. The company is developing a new way for people to have a digital wallet on their smartphones. So the question is, why would people leave their degree that they are working on to go and work for a company that has not yet come into existence? It's because they heard something. Go to the next slide.
Hey, Cappy Borders here, back in the studio. You are watching Imagination TV. Make sure to check out ImaginationTV.com for the best on-demand access to the world's most fascinating motivators, producers, educators, and authors. We will be right back after these messages.
Go to the next slide. What I want you to get out of this particular session is, what do you here. Because in the last session, I asked you, what did you see? And now I'm asking you, what do you
hear?
What do you hear? Let me unpack this, and I must lay this groundwork, so if you will just indulge me for a second, because this is very important for where we're going. Our senses create a perception about life and what is happening around us. Hearing is all about a vibration. Our inner ear picks up the vibrations that are moving through the airwaves and detects the sound and translates what's being heard. In the 1940s, an aircraft would experience compression that struck the plane, thereby impacting it from further acceleration. Scientists believe that the drag on the aircraft caused by the approaching speed made it impossible for it to reach or to exceed the speed of sound without being destroyed. In the 1950s, through advancing technology, aircrafts were able to effortlessly break the sound barrier. Now, as you know, sound is a type of energy made by vibrations. When any other object vibrates, it causes a sound wave that you hear. Now, what's interesting about this, I believe a part of why you are attracted to a certain place is because when it is time for you to step into a new dimension and domain of wealth, you have to have the sound barrier broken off of you. In other words, God wants you to break your sound barrier. Because if you think about it, follow this with me. Over the last few years, we have been hearing, as a result of constant negative news, everything that was wrong in the world, layoffs, a currency, everything that could be wrong went wrong. And the more and more you continue to hear something, it creates a sound or a barrier that you can't do something. But I believe people that exist and call the name of God, the reason you must begin to say what God says is because there needs to be a vibration that happens in the spirit that causes you to break your sound barrier. So the reason my faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word. I must hear a word to break the sound barrier that is all around me. Because my God, oh, I feel it in here. When I break, everybody say break. When I break the sound barrier, every word that has been spoken against me, I am able to accelerate it and move past it because there's a vibration in my spirit that when I hear who I am and why I am, I say, yeah, baby, that's me. So anybody, my God, anybody that comes along to say opposite of what I believe, I said, no, 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 reject, because I've broken the sound barrier. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. It's going to get good in a minute. It's going to get good in a minute. So when I understand that I must pay attention to what I hear, I recognize, how does hearing come? Hearing in our world comes through the transference of the television. How do I begin to hear what is happening real time? It's because I've been tuned into the television. Yeah. So when it is time for you to go to another dimension in God, you must change the channel on the because the moment I start telling myself a new story, my spirit begins to hear, so shall it be, that goeth forth out of my mouth, it shall not return void. So in other words, the word comes to break your sound barrier. And when the word breaks your sound barrier, it creates a vibration. Vibration. When you understand how a radio works, you understand that a radio, back in the day, old school, there was a tuner and a frequency, and if you really wanted to dial in, you had to get to the right frequency. And when you got to the right frequency, you could hear crystal clear what was coming through the radio. Everybody tracking with me so far? If you know anything about a tuning fork, if you were to tap it on a table, it releases a vibration in the atmosphere. If there is another tuning fork that's in close proximity to the first tuning fork, the second tuning fork picks up on the vibration of the first one, and it begins to vibrate and oscillate at the same pitch. Now, why is that important to you? Because when you understand who you are and what you carry, every single day you are vibrating into the universe opportunities, ideas, concepts. And what happens is you connect with someone who is connected to your destiny and you begin to resonate with them. And the reason, my God, oh, I feel it in here. The reason you resonate with them and you stop communicating and you start connecting is because of the resonation, you are all humming and vibrating on the same frequency. In other words, you are now in tune. When you're in tune, when you're in tune, you pick up on the vibrations, and all of a sudden, as you begin to know each other, you enter into what they call commonality. Commonality is, what do we have in common? And the more and more we begin to dialogue, scientists say that if you were to measure our heartbeat in the moment, our heartbeat would be beating at the same pace. Because I am not just hearing you, I'm listening to you. So, practical takeaway number one, that if I am to hear and understand the intuition of wealth, I must realize the same letters that spell the word listen spell the word silent. When I understand the same letters that spell the word listen, spell the word silent, and I connect with somebody that resonates with me, I shut up and I release the need to be right. When I release the need to be right and I am silent, I'm waiting to hear a sound. And when I hear that sound, there's a connection. Seth Godin, a futurist, has written a new book called The Icarus Deception, and he says that we have moved into the connection economy. People are sick and tired of being communicated, being spammed, everything is thrown at them, and there is no connection. I am telling you, if you don't get anything else out of this entrepreneurs conference, oh brilliant one, I want you to get that when you leave this place, I want you to think about, what's my connection? How do I begin to connect with people? Not for what I can get from them, but what I can give to them. Because when I begin to take that posture, I am going to begin to hear like I have never heard before, because it's not about me. I am waiting for the opportunity to serve. But I can't serve if my mouth is moving faster than my mind. I can't serve if I'm trying to look at what I can get from you. I can't serve and really hear if I come to you with hat in hand. I can't serve if I am not following up, because don't miss this. The fortune is in the follow-up. So when I'm really listening, I am coming to a place of connection. Everybody say connection. All right, now, Let me just take you to the Word very quickly because I want to make sure that we are honoring God's Word. Go with me to Matthew chapter number 14 and verse number 25. Matthew 14, 25. And it says, in the fourth watch of the night, he came unto them. How many realize them means more than one? Walking upon the sea. And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were troubled, saying, it is a ghost. And they cried out for fear. But straightway Jesus spoke unto them, saying, be of good cheer, it is I, be not afraid. And Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto thee upon the waters. And he said, come. And Peter went down from the boat and walked on the waters to come to Jesus. Now, I don't want you to miss this, because we're about to take this to another level. What's interesting is when you look at this scripture, so many people talk about Peter walking on the water. But I just want to spend a few moments and say to you, now, what's interesting, if Peter got down to walk on the water, what happened to all the other guys in the boat? Why didn't they walk on water? Go to the next slide for me. Here's what I want you to think about. I want you, at this season, if you're gonna hear like you have never heard before, you're gonna have to. You're gonna have to. You're gonna have to. Turn to your neighbor and say, get out of the boat. Now, what's interesting, how is it that people can, and the disciples can see Jesus walking on the water and afraid, but then they hear his voice. They heard his voice, but they were afraid. But Peter had a different spirit. There was something in him that said, this is my moment. This is my opportunity. I heard something different. And he decided to get out of the boat. Now, what happens, I believe, the reason he got out of the boat, because he was sick and tired of hanging with guys who had boat mentality. Boat mentality says, it's never been done before. I can't see how you're going to make it. Are you crazy? Have you lost your mind? Why are you going to spend that money? Why are you going to that conference? Why are you reading books? Why don't you return my call? Why don't you answer my text? Why don't you respond to my email? Why don't you meet me for coffee? Why don't we go for dinner? Why don't we vacation together? I can't do it because I heard the word come. My God.
Hey, Cappy Borders here, back in the studio. You are watching Imagination TV. Make sure to check out ImaginationTV.com for the best on-demand access to the world's most fascinating motivators, producers, educators, and authors. We will be right back after these messages.
I just came to let you know that God wants you to step out on the word come. Some of you have been thinking about ideas and do I make this move and do I do this and do I do that? But you never know until you come, you'll realize that Jesus is coming from the other way. But you gotta get out and walk on water, because guess what? Walking on water is not safe. Walking on water is not popular. Walking on water is not easy. Walking on water makes you ostracized and make people talk about you and not befriend you and not like you. Guess what? I'm not in a clique. I'm not in a club. I am who I am. Hey! Hallelujah. Oh my God. When you get out of the boat, I just need you to take your right leg. I know you're sitting next to somebody, but I want you to, you know, in a couple of weeks, they're gonna have Churchill Downs on, and that horse is gonna be ready to go. I just need you to get your right leg and just get out of the boat. Just get out of the boat. That's right, I want you to get out of the boat. Why? Why get out of the boat? Get out of the boat because you have water walking faith. Get out of the boat because the potential of God is in you. Get out of the boat because the genius of God is in you. Get out of the boat because the power of God is going to be released through you. Now,
Now, why? Why get out of the boat? Listen, there's not an economic problem in the state of Ohio. Believers haven't stepped into their position to walk on water. Because if we would walk on water, God would give us ideas and insights for witty inventions that everybody that has been laid off in the state of Ohio, or wherever you are from in the country, or wherever you are from in the world, to say, guess what? If I'm blessed to be a blessing, I'm supposed to create something to employ people. Stop looking to your state government. Stop looking to Washington, D.C. Whatever country, those of you from London, stop looking to 10 Downing Street and begin to say, what is the potential and the genius of God in me, and what do I hear? Because when I pay attention to what I hear, I got to get out of the boat. Because boat mentality represents limitation. Boat mentality represents small thinking. Boat mentality represents being comfortable. Boat mentality represents the status quo. Boat mentality represents being average. Boat mentality means I'm just a bill. Well, I'm only a bill, and I'm sitting here in Capitol Hill. But when you understand, some of y'all will get that later, but when you understand, that's familiar, I've heard that before. No, when you understand, who you are, you become very mindful of what do you hear. Because what I hear causes me to do. So if I told you, see it and say it, now I'm inviting you to hear it and do it. Because until I do what I have heard, it's only information without application. And where there is no application, there is no revelation. But when I look for revelation, it starts with application, which came from information. But I must start with, what am I hearing? So here's my challenges to you. Those of you who are committed to being marketplace entrepreneurs, did you know that according to Christianity Today, that if there are 7 billion people on the planet, almost 2 billion people consider themselves Christians? 15% of the 2 billion work in what they call fivefold ministry. So the question that you have, like I had, oh, brilliant one, what about the other 85%? The other 85% have to get out of the boat and take the marketplace, because your life might be the only Bible that people read. So when I understand that, when you show up to do what you do, what do people hear? Because you are vibrating something. If you're taking notes, write this down. Write this down. Everything speaks. Everything speaks. Even when you're quiet, your actions speak louder than everything speaks. When you walk into a room, what do people hear? What do they say? Are you the person that walks in with the spirit of optimism that says, we're gonna be okay? We're gonna get through this. This is not the end. What do they hear you say? Because when you get out of the boat and use water walking faith, you become unstoppable. You become the go-to person. You become the person in your market, in your industry, that is a subject matter expert that people say, you know what? We have to go and connect with you because you are where things are going. If you say, I have heard that I can be the best, but I don't do anything towards that end, then you just have information. But how you're gonna execute that is, what can I do? The moment you begin to apply, you discover a little becomes a lot over a long period of time. Now, let me give you some specific things to think about. Everybody says, get bigger, get bigger. And you do realize that small is the new big. So here's what I want you to think about, entrepreneurs. Before you get bigger, get better. Truett Cathy, who is the founder of Chick-fil-A, was having a meeting with all of his executives. And his executives at this time was saying, Boston Chicken Market has eaten our market share. We've got to expand. We've got to keep up with them. And Truett Cathy was tired of hearing them, and he pounded the table. And he said, if we get better, our customers will force us to get bigger. I can stop right there and go home if you just caught that little piece. The one thing I want you thinking about right now, if we are going to be the best of the best, we must begin to hear in the spirit a sound. We must begin to hear what everybody else is not hearing, and we must ask the Holy Spirit, Holy Spirit, for the anointing that you've called me to have in the marketplace, would you speak to me and give me a divine download? And that download is only going to come when you get silent and listen. Because in the noise of the day, the Holy Spirit comes in a still, small voice, and you sense something in your gut. And the resonation or the vibration that you sense in your gut is because you heard the voice say, come. Peter stepped out on the words of the master when he said, come, while the rest of them jokers stayed in the boat and said, have you lost your mind? At this season, God is releasing a billionaire anointing, a billionaire anointing. God wants you to think bigger than you have ever thought before. No more small thinking. If you're thinking small, you need to say times 10. Upgraded. Why did God bring you to a place called the now? He brought you to the place called the now because you needed an upgrade. See, whenever you look at software, when it is upgraded, that means that the new upgrade has some things that the previous thing didn't have in. So the reason you've got to upgrade yourself is because your inner ear needs new revelation and a new confirmation of what you've been sensing in your gut. That's why Pastor Gary can stand up here and say something to you. You say, baby, that was for me. Well, how did he know? It's because he was talking from the Spirit. And when Spirit to Spirit talk, there's a connection. Oh, my God. I want a connection. Oh, I'm sick and tired of people yapping, people communicating, a lot of white noise. Baby, I want to hear in my deep spirit, God, what are you saying? What do you want to do through me? Use me, God, because the richest place in the entire world is the cemetery. People who never heard what they could be. Just turn to your neighbor and say, what do you hear? What are you hearing? Because what I am hearing changes the channel on the television. It does. And the more and more it changes the channel on the television, then what I discover is that the most powerful place in the entire universe is the movie screen of your mind. Because on the movie screen of your mind, there is a sound. Because if there is no sound associated with the pictures, then it's just pictures. But my inner ear has to pick up on the frequency and tune in to the picture of a coming attraction in my life. So the reason when you look at this gentleman, the first billionaire in Vietnam, he sensed something. And he began to move out and go to a place that no one would go, to do something and to pick up on something and to hear something. What are you going to hear this season that you've never heard before? And then what are you going to do about it? And how are you going to get better? Now, I want to leave you with this thought, and then we're going to do something. You come to great conferences, and you're in church Sunday in, Sunday out, during the week. You listen to CDs in your car. But I want you to begin to think about, what am I going to do so that I will mark this day down in history and say, this was the moment when I heard it and it brought about a shift and I got out of the boat. Whatever getting out of the boat means to you. I want you in a moment to turn to the person you're sitting next to, and I want you to just take a little time, and we're going to talk to each other. I'm going to give you about a minute and a half just to connect. And the question I want you to ask each other is, what are you going to do to get out of the boat? Whatever that means to you. And I want you to listen and dial in with each other. And then we're going to come back, and I'm going to give you the next set of instructions, okay? Go ahead and connect. Go ahead and connect. Connect with old brilliant one. What are you going to do to get out of the boat? What are you going to do? Yes, thank you. Seconds, 30 seconds. Ten seconds. Okay, let's come back together. Now, do me a favor. What you just shared with old brilliant one, if you have a pen, if you have a piece of paper, please, ma'am, please, sir, write it down. Just write it down very quickly. If you think it, ink it. If you think it, ink it. Write it down. Whatever you shared, okay? Now, as you're writing that down, here's the next set of instructions. Whoever you shared with, you are now each other's accountability partner. Absolutely. And here's why I do this. Most of the work that I do is in corporate America. I maybe talk to maybe three or four churches in a year's time, so that's why I have to kind of like get it all in, because like I don't know when I'll have this opportunity again, because on Monday morning I'll be like, hi, please turn to this page. I'll be very corporate, very prim and proper. So when I come and see my kinfolk here in Ohio, I have to let it all hang out, okay? But part of the reason why I wanted you to share with Oh Brilliant One, and I want you to write it down, because one of the things that's happening in corporate America is that CEOs want men and women to take ownership of what they know to do and don't wait for innovation to come from the top. Innovate where you are. So the reason I want you working with an accountability partner is over this next 6 weeks, I want you to take one time a week, call each other, or if you're with your spouse, connect with each other once a week for 5 minutes and say, so what have you done since you decided to get out of the boat? And how's it going? Now, if you're sitting next to somebody you don't know, say you gotta call me, hold me accountable, because the Bible says iron sharpeneth iron, okay? Here's the other thing. One of the big things that you will, if you haven't already heard, people or companies want people to be flexible and adapt. And in adapting and being flexible, you're gonna have to unlearn and relearn. In other words, when someone says something, we all hear through filters, but what we must do is detach ourselves from the intent of what they're saying, catch it, and move on.
Hey, Cappy Borders here, back in the studio. You are watching Imagination TV. Make sure to check out ImaginationTV.com for the best on-demand access to the world's most fascinating motivators, producers, educators, and authors. We will be right back after these messages.
Because a lot of times people say, well, why are they asking me to do this? And blah, 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 blah. Seriously, really, get over it, okay? Deal with it. Because what I've discovered in many businesses that I've worked in over the years, a number of people, when they first came in, they came in as a cheetah, but over time became a hippo. Yeah, it's true. A cheetah, swiftest hunter in Africa, a cheetah, flexible spine, can run up to 70 miles per hour. When it pursues its prey, it doesn't chase and chase all around, it stalks its prey. And the stalking goes from about 20 seconds to 1 minute, then it pounces its prey. A hippo, lazy, ornery, set in its ways. Why do we need to do this? Why do we need to change? I was teaching this to a group of PhDs, MBAs, and somebody in the back says, what happens when you put a cheetah with a hippo? They said you get a cheapo. Okay, anyway. Anyway, but here's the point. Every business needs the cheetah and every business needs the hippo. Because the hippo knows where the bodies are buried, the hippo knows where the landmines are, they've been there, done that, got the t-shirt. And when the cheetahs come in as the youngsters, as the young whippersnappers with all the fresh ideas, the hippos can say, let's think about that a little bit differently. Now, why do I share that? Because all of us have to begin to say, if I am going to hear at a whole nother level, do I have people in my life that represent every generation that exists on the earth? Do I have some 20-year-olds in my life? What I call the swipe generation, because we are moving very quickly and have moved from a point and click world to a touch and swipe world. So do I have some 20-year-olds? Do I have some 30-year-olds? Do I have some 40-year-olds? Do I have some 50-year-olds? Do I have some 60-year-olds? Do I have some 70-year-olds that's been there, done that, got the t-shirt? Because I'm able to hear and listen to the wisdom at every age and every stage. One of my best mentors in my life is a guy named Joel Novak. Joel, 72 years of age. We talk once a week on the phone. He imparts wisdom. I ask questions. I don't have my hat in hand. And what I hear, it shapes how I think. Because when you're hearing, it's not about being right. It's about what do I do with what I've heard, okay? All of us are here because we heard the voice of Jesus and we said yes to the Lord. I just want to say thank you for this opportunity to serve you. I don't know when I will see you again, but about 45 days ago, I buried my dad. And my dad, as he was on his bed transitioning, He came just for a moment, and he said to me three times, whatever you do, put God first. Whatever you do, put God first. Whatever you do, put God first. And then he said, I love you, I believe in you. And that was it. And I don't know if this is the last time for me, God forbid, but if I don't see you again, on behalf of my dad, who would have been married to my mom for 47 years this July, I want to let you know I love you and I believe in you. And I want you to get out of the boat, pay attention to that sense in your gut, and hear the wealth. Just hear the wealth. I hear a sound. I hear a sound. Something's getting ready to change. You need to say to yourself, you won't recognize me this time next year. You're not going to recognize me. You're not going to recognize me. Because I heard a sound. I love you. I believe in you. There's not a darn thing you can do about it. Thank you very much.